you love to make a scene.
Today I talked to Chelsea Jade, who has just released her second album, Soft Spot. Born in South Africa, raised in New Zealand, and now living in Brooklyn, Chelsea is balancing careers as a dancer, a musician, and a visual artist. So we start our music talk by asking how Soft Spot got its start.
Well, at the beginning of 2020, I had a lot of plans laid, including some kind of record that I hadn't quite finished yet. And then obviously plans all disintegrated at the same time as everyone else's did. So kind of re-examined my goals. And I kind of took a beat and then I just started going through around like maybe July. I started kind of going through all of the kind of work I'd started in the couple of years preceding. And I kind of lacked perspective on all of it, but I did think, you know, I won't really understand what to do next until I finish all of this. And so I kind of started a regimen of paying attention to these songs that were nearly there, you know. But maybe when I was maybe 80% finished, I signed with Carpark Records, and we started planning together to release them. So, and that's how Soft Spot came to be.
So how did you and Carpark come together?
So my friend Liz, who's in a band called the Beths,
yep.
We've known each other since we were 13, and we were in our first band together back then. And
the Teacups, right?
Teacups, yeah. Yeah, so she had been sending Carpark my demos. I had put out a record myself in 2018, just by myself. They just were enthusiastic about it. And of course, Liz's endorsement couldn't be stronger for me. I really trust Liz's experiences, and she had a great experience. So she put us in touch, and then so it goes.
And so it goes. So where and when did most of the recording take place for the record?
It's honestly been all over the show. Right. Not a very linear process. I could tell you where I got the last probably 30% over the line, which is in Auckland.
Okay.
during the first lockdown that happened right after I got there, after my lockdown for the 2 weeks in the hotel. But I had access to a studio space via APRA, the PRO of New Zealand, and I was still able to go in there by myself during lockdown. So yeah, that's when a lot of the final touches and a lot of the vocals were recorded in there, just me by myself.
So you didn't have an engineer or anybody to kind of bounce things off with? You were by yourself?
No.
That's weird.
Yeah, so I guess like half Los Angeles and half Auckland. Yeah.
And does it make a difference for you where you are when you're creating the music?
No. I suppose, you know, what makes a difference is whether the room you're in is equipped to be recorded
right.
in. And I feel like that's something I really value about the time in the APRA studio was it really kind of imbued me with the confidence that I had a lot of competence. It's amazing what a soundproof room will give you in terms of it really chips away at any kind of frustration that one might have with their recording techniques. It's a much cleaner experience.
Right, right. So do you find it kind of intimidating in a studio sometimes?
No, I find it a relief.
A relief.
Yeah. Of course, yeah, because I mean, otherwise, prior to that, I'd been working on it in my studio apartment in Los Angeles, which I loved the apartment, but it had a lot of sound bleed,
right,
and a lot of immediate neighbors. So yeah, at one point I was like, I could hear this buzz. I could hear this endless buzz. And I opened my front door, which is, you know, the whole room of the apartment. It's a studio apartment. Is just behind this front door, and it was the goddamn hallway light. Like, what can I do about that?
Yeah. Nice to have a bit of control. Now, I see you worked with a gentleman by the name of Leroy James Clampett. There's this tune called Optimist on the record that you and he worked together on and kind of co-produced. Tell me about why you work with him and how you work with him.
Yeah, so Leroy and I actually made Superfan and Optimist together. He's actually just a longtime friend. We came to Los Angeles at a similar time, and just prior to that, we were judging a children's music competition. We drove around New Zealand, coaching and judging children.
There you go.
But Leroy had he and I worked together a lot when I first moved to Los Angeles in 2015. I would take a bus to his studio, which was behind a vape shop in like Santa Monica area. And then he kind of he's just a incredibly, I learned a lot from working with him because he's got so much, there are no barriers when it comes to working with Leroy. He's got a great attitude. We're close outside of music.
Right.
And so it was very comfortable to kind of, collaborate. And, in terms of Optimist, I had asked for a session for my birthday. And so we were just kind of in his studio one day and, messing around. And the first thing we recorded was, for Superfan was the squeaky voice,
right,
hook. Yeah. And then when it came to Optimist, I can't even remember the, I think probably the chorus was the first thing we came up with. I just liked the phrase, I'm almost positive it's love, like holding back on, with the cynicism is still present and you haven't totally bought into the optimism of new love, and then kind of building the song around that concept, which is, and then I took that away and I did quite a lot of it on my own, and kind of added my friend playing the upright bass, which is all through the second verse and kind of speaks more to the cynical side of the song, much darker, and juxtaposed with the rest, which is kind of sweeter and has a kind of, I guess it toes the line between a melancholic 60s girl group and a kind of sexually explicit 90s R&B songs.
Yeah. Alrighty. Now, you did a video for Optimist and also Best Behavior, and I think another one, Good Taste. So how involved do you get in the visual representation of you and your songs?
So it's all me, especially Optimist and Best Behavior. So, I mean, Optimist, to start off with, is almost entirely me. I learned a lot about video editing and After Effects and animation and the and kind of like building a certain kind of specific logic that is, I guess, very specific to me. It's kind of, I'd say it's the logic of a flurry.
Okay.
But yeah, I take a lot of pride. I mean, I went to art school and the visual component is kind of probably a large reason why I'm in pop music as opposed to another kind of music, because it really is a marriage of the visual and the sonic, in my opinion. And so, yeah, and I feel very proud of the videos I've made for this. I think, especially because the video was just re-released for Superfan, which is part of a long-time collaboration with my friend Alexander Gander, who's a video director in New Zealand. Uh-huh. And I kind of took the reins on these videos because I just thought there was a lot left for me to understand and build, because I wanted to become more of a, I'd like to go back to Alex and have more of a defined language about, you know, really build. I really enjoy working with Alex.
Do you have an idea for the video in your head when you're writing the song, or does when you're working on the video, does it change the way you ultimately think about the song? Does it have any effect on it?
No, because I don't really think of anything as, I know that it's very common to think of yourself in eras, you know, in pop music. Right. But really, I think that my aim as an artist is to build my own style and not really take into account the external aspects. And so I think that it's just a continuation of a language. And in order to do that, I think I find it difficult to be in two places at once. I'll put it that way. So I feel like the song has to be complete before I can understand what it is and then approach the visual components. Yeah.
Now the album ends with a tune called Night Swimmer, which I think I've read that you, when you wrote that was kind of the first song that you wrote that you felt belonged to you under your own name. I don't know if that's true or not, but if it is, what does that mean exactly?
What do you think of the song?
Oh yeah, I thought it was a lovely mood to end the record, because it kind of eased you out.
Say that you feel the weight of the weather now. It's riding on your back like I'm riding on you now. Say that you feel the weight, that you feel the weight, that you feel the weight.
I think it really contains a lot of my taste that is consistent throughout my undulation of learning about different possibilities in kind of like an audio aesthetic. Mm-hmm. And so it's important to me because I think it hasn't since I wrote it, it still felt relevant to me, and it's been around for a little while. So having it just pressed to wax was really important to me. And I also just think the themes of it, anything that mentions bodies of water, mm-hmm. whenever I get the chance to mention a body of water, I feel like it locks in as something that's very indicative of my priorities, because I really think about that a lot, just probably because I've darted around the globe quite a lot, finding a sense of place.
So what brought you to Brooklyn? Because you were living in LA, and they're very different places.
They are very different. I think I'm very interested in the contemporary dance world, and it's a very strong New York is just, I mean, absolutely overflowing with beautiful dance work. So I'm excited to get involved.
And are you getting involved?
Yeah, so I'm currently doing a residency at Oceanfront Studio, which is a DIY dance space. I came to that through going to performances and specifically getting involved with Sarah Kinlaw, who is definitely just someone I really admire. She's an incredible artist I've been aware of for a long time. primarily as a dancer, but then she put out a record that I really loved, so in the pop realm. So I just felt even more connection to her, and it's resulted in this kind of wonderful offer to use this space. So
cool.
Definitely getting involved, yeah.
So do you think of your dance and your music as two separate things? Do they merge? How do you approach the two of them?
Yeah, I mean, when I feel most connected to music, even especially that music I haven't made, it's when I'm walking around listening to it and kind of the cinematic notion of feeling alone with it. And also, it's so in headphones, you know, it's so omnipresent, right, in a way. And you can feel, in my case, I walk around dancing. So, certainly that's a priority when I'm writing music too. Yeah.
Okay. So what is your next creative endeavor?
I certainly have a lot of irons ready to be put in the fire, but I feel like I don't know what's going to take flight yet, so I'll keep it percolating before I say too much.
And are you doing live shows and things, or what's happening there?
I definitely like to, yeah. That's definitely something I'd like to do.
And do the songs take on a different form when you perform live?
I think they just become fully themselves, actually. I think it's so vital for music to have interaction, a physical interaction involved. And I think I really hear the songs properly either when other people are playing them or when I get to play them to people. I mean, that's something about the live show or the way that I play live. There's a lot of interaction with the crowd.
Right.
And I think that's part of it. It's kind of like, we're sharing in something, and this isn't about me really anymore.
And do you hang out with the fans afterwards at the merch table and all that stuff and have some kind of interaction there as well?
Definitely. That's honestly one of my favorite parts. It's so nice.
It's very different because you can tell I'm older. So the idea of that happening like back in the 70s when I was going to lots of concerts would never happen, you know. You'd go see the Rolling Stones and suddenly Mick and Keith are standing out at the merch table. It would be unthinkable. So,
yeah. I can't imagine, like, I think it's so much part of the purpose of it that I can't imagine not having it.
Very good. All right. So are you coming back to New Zealand anytime soon, or are you there for a while?
I'd really love to come back to New Zealand when the opportunity arises. Yeah, I mean, I always take the opportunity when it does. So,
very good. Have a great day. Okay. Thank you very much.
Okay, bye.
Bye-bye.